Good morning, everybody. We really have a terrific program today. I'm Bonnie Glazer. I'm a senior advisor for Asia at CSIS. And of course, I do a great deal of work on Asian security writ large, but one of the things that I really enjoy focusing on is Taiwan. And so I'm very pleased that you're all here today to hear the remarks both of Congressman Matt Salmon and TECRA representative and ambassador Shen Lushun. And I will also summarize the report which we are rolling out today on Taiwan's participation in the international community. And you should all have a copy of that. So we will have time for a Q&A, both with Congressman Salmon and with Ambassador Shen. But we will start with the Congressman because he has a hard end time, has to get back to the Hill. So let me start by introducing briefly Congressman Matt Salmon, who is all of you know represents the people of Arizona's 5th Congressional District and has recently become the chairman of the Subcommittee on the Asia-Pacific, also serves in the House Committee on Foreign Affairs and the House Committee on Education and the Workforce. In terms of his own personal background, many of you may know that Congressman Salmon in his youth served a mission for his church in southern Taiwan from 1977 to 1979. And we were just chatting about how the congressman left Taiwan in January 1979, and I arrived as a student there in February 1979. So unfortunately, we didn't overlap. He traveled extensively around the island during his stay, and I think undoubtedly has a very keen appreciation for Taiwan, including the accomplishments of its people and their longing to be a more active participant in the international community. Congressman Salmon was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives in 1994. He served 3 terms, and then after a hiatus of 12 years, his constituents reelected him to serve again in the House. Congressman Salmon has led multiple U.S. delegations to China and Taiwan, and he is the only member of Congress who is fluent in Mandarin. Yesterday, Congressman Salmon chaired a subcommittee hearing on opportunities and challenges facing the U.S. in the Asia-Pacific, and his remarks at the hearing clearly demonstrate his commitment to promoting American interests in the Asia-Pacific. And I think we can all agree that under Congressman Salmon's leadership, the Subcommittee on Asia is going to make very important contributions to U.S. policy and interests going forward. So with that, please join me in welcoming Congressman Salmon.
Well, thank you very much. It's really an honor to be here today. And Ambassador, it's great to see you again. Welcome back to Washington, D.C. I know it's been about a year now since you came back. But to me, it's like Groundhog Day, because when I first came, he was here. And then he went to Geneva, and he's been in several different places. But it's wonderful. It's actually a really good thing, because I think you represent Taiwan extremely well, and I want you to know that my support for Taiwan is undying, and I think that we'll be able to do some good things in the next couple of years. I fully expect that I'll be in this job for quite some time, probably until I get it right, and we'll have lots of opportunities to do great things. And Bonnie Glazer, thank you so much for this opportunity. It's a real honor. I'm sure you and I looked a lot different in 1979.
Absolutely.
In fact, my deputy chief of staff just said, when you were mentioning that I was there from 77 to 79, that I'm really old. And so thank you for that. Actually, in China, the older you are, the wiser you are. At least that's the... So hopefully I'm wiser. I don't know that my wife would agree with that. She says I'm a pretty wise guy. I'm really excited to be the chairman of the Asia and Pacific subcommittee. It's been something that I've been interested in ever since I lived in Taiwan. And I think that given the fact that I actually have been to the region numerous times, I lived in Taiwan for 2 years, and I've been to China over 40 times and spent a lot of time working there. I've been to India 5 or 6 times and spent a lot of time working there, South Korea, Japan. I think it's probably the first time in American history that we've had a chairman of that subcommittee that actually speaks Mandarin. So I think maybe that's a good thing too. Hushang Liaojia, mutual understanding to me is a very important thing. And so I think that it will be a very positive thing. When I first was called by my church to go to Taiwan, I was 19 years old and not real world-wise. I didn't even know where Taiwan was, to be honest with you. I knew that they spoke a different language, but I hadn't taken any foreign language in high school. And so when I first was sent to the language training mission in Provo, Utah, to learn Chinese, we got there on a Wednesday, and then by Sunday, we were forbidden to speak in English anymore. We had to speak in Chinese. We called that Silent Sunday. We did a lot of pointing and grunting. But it was a great experience for me. We were studying the Chinese language 24/7, literally. I mean, we were probably sleeping 6 hours, studying every day. In fact, we had our kechengs strapped to our hip, and we were studying them even when we were in the lunch line. And it was a great experience for me. When I got to Taiwan, I was so thankful to get out of that language training mission and be somewhere where we could actually interact with the people of Taiwan. And they were so wonderful to me. In fact, it was like having a home away from home, a family in another place. In fact, I remember getting kind of sick when I was there. The people of Taiwan just adopted me like one of their own sons. And I'll never forget that. I was there during the time that Jimmy Carter normalized relations with China and severed diplomatic ties with Taiwan, and it was a really sad day for me. It was very hard to take. And since that time, the United States has adopted a one-China policy. But, you know, I said in the hearing yesterday, and I'll say it again, and I hope some of the people from Beijing are listening. If you really want a peaceful reunification with Taiwan someday, then you have to mean what you say about one China, two systems with Hong Kong. So far, it hasn't really materialized. And that's why these protests have occurred in Hong Kong, because of Beijing's meddling in the whole democratic process in Hong Kong, especially in the selection of a CEO. And if they really want to show the world that they mean what they say about one China, two systems, then they'll actually practice what they preach, and they'll really have one China, two systems. I'm really pleased with the things that President Ma has done to try to build a unity between China and Taiwan and de-escalate some of the tensions that have occurred in the Taiwan Strait. I had opportunity in my past experience in Congress to meet with then-President Jiang Zemin. And every time we talked about the cross-strait relations, it was kind of like a dentist drilling on somebody's teeth without Novocaine. He'd get real exercised about it and assert how it was part of China. And to me, I think the United States can still operate under a one-China policy, but yet pursue it in a smart way. It doesn't make any sense. Right now, the ambiguous sovereignty status, and which is leading to its exclusion from the vast majority of international organizations. Taiwan is an extremely important partner of the United States. And I believe that we need to reiterate time and time again the Taiwan Relations Act and our support for that as a people, as a Congress, as a government. And I also believe that the support for Taiwan in the international community, as well as the supply of defensive military supplies, needs to be a continued priority for the United States. Taiwan's marginalization in international organizations leaves a significant hole in the security of the Asia-Pacific region. I think we all understand that. It also leaves Taiwan's 23 million people vulnerable. Taiwan has the means and the desire and the capacity to serve as a responsible global stakeholder. And President Ma, He's facing, I know, some important political struggles at home, but he should be commended for his efforts to help bring security to the region, specifically his efforts to peacefully resolve regional disputes, and they should serve as an example to the entire Asia region. And I've mentioned that several times in past hearings, and I will continue to advocate listening to President Ma and his desire for a peace initiative and some talks among some of the parties that are concerned about China's aggression in the East and South China Sea. And I think that he has done a marvelous job continuing to advocate for the following of international law, continued dialogue, and the sharing of natural resources to work toward these peaceful relations. And Taiwan should also be afforded the benefit, though, from international security bodies and share its reservoir of knowledge and expertise for common good. That's just common sense. We live in such a dangerous world. Why limit our abilities to be able to cooperate with one government to another to eventually stomp out and eradicate the threat of terrorism? And the, you know, it's just like when we talk about solving problems, that two heads are better than one. We need everybody at the table. We need everybody at the table, and there is no good reason that Taiwan should be excluded from many of these international bodies. And I think that the United States, while we say we support that, I think we need to belly up to the bar. I think we need to do more than just say that, and we need to lobby some of these other governments to adopt our position and use the political capital that we have with those nations to vote with us to make sure that these things ultimately happen. It's just common sense. And I know that China is incredibly concerned about what's happening with North Korea. I know that they're incredibly concerned about the extremist radical growth of these terrorist groups and these radical Muslim groups. And so I think that it's just, we're at the point right now where we need to stop walking on eggshells, and we need to stop trying to, I don't know, placate or appease China's desire to try to keep its thumb on Taiwan. It just isn't good sense, and it's not good policy, not for Taiwan, not for China, not for the world. And I'm going to be a staunch advocate of doing the right thing, the smart thing, and the best thing. And I really appreciate the opportunity to be here today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congressman, and thank you for your support, your service to our nation, of course, and your support for Taiwan. So I don't want to dominate the conversation because I know there are many questions that are from the audience, but I do want to at least start out asking you one question. Now, the focus of our report really is on Taiwan's security and the need to integrate Taiwan into security mechanisms. But of course, economics and security are just inextricably linked.
Very much so.
And one of the issues that I know is on the minds of President Ma, and interestingly, really is an area of consensus between the opposition, the DPP, and the Kuomintang, is the desire to become more integrated economically into the region and globally, and particularly to join, if possible, if the TPP becomes a reality, which I think we would share the view that we hope that it will be. So what do you think are the prospects, assuming that we have a TPP agreement later this year, for Taiwan to join?
Well, I think it's just common sense. You know, China might want to pretend otherwise, but Taiwan is the biggest investor in China's economy. And I think that it just makes sense to have all hands on deck. Taiwan is a big importer of U.S. products and services, and it's a big exporter to the United States. And it just makes sense. And so while I'm a big advocate of TPP, I think that ultimately, whether it's TPP or other economic opportunities, to leave Taiwan out is just flat out dumb.
I would agree. If you look out maybe 10 years, where do you expect to see Taiwan in relationship to the mainland and the United States? Do you think that we will still see the status quo, or do you think we will see radical change?
I would have really hoped that with China's entry into the WTO and the passage of PNTR, in fact, I said this back then. I hoped I was a prophet. I really guess I wasn't, but I had said at the time that I believed that since China had kind of opened the genie's bottle by letting out the economy and economic freedom of sorts, that political reform wasn't far behind. It's just a natural segue. And the political reform in China has been slow to non-existent, and I'm really disappointed. I think it will ultimately be to their detriment. As long as they continue to try to play a heavy hand with Hong Kong, which I had hoped would be different. I was there for the Hong Kong handover ceremony, met with some of the dissidents like Martin Lee, and really hoped that China would practice a more hands-off approach to Hong Kong than they have. Hoped and prayed that some of the human rights issues in China would have been better than they would now. Right now, there is a detente of sorts between Taiwan and China, but I give almost all the credit to President Ma, almost all of it. I don't think China has really done much of anything to improve those relations. It's Taiwan that's made almost all the efforts at improving that relationship. And I think that China has been pushing the envelope time and time again with its aggression, with the Spratlys and other issues in the South China Sea and East China Sea. And I truly do believe that if they don't listen to some of these calls for reasonable dialogue like President Ma has issued, the world is going to start turning against them. And they need to realize that their economy, I know they don't care as much about political reform as they do about their economic prospects, but if they continue to put the lid on any kind of political reform and working with with Taiwan, I think the world of public opinion is going to move against them. And I think it's in their best economic interest to sit down at the table and try to iron out some of these issues and be reasonable about allowing Taiwan to participate in the world process. It's actually kind of childish, I think.
Well, of course, we have seen some progress in terms of Taiwan expanding its participation in the international community under President Ma.
Not enough.
But not enough.
No.
Absolutely
not
enough.
Even close to enough.
Not even close, yes.
Right.
And the risks are growing, and we will talk about that more a little
right.
bit later. So let me open up the floor now to questions from the audience. Please identify yourself, your affiliation, and please make your question relatively short because we only have about 20 minutes. Over here, wait for the microphone, please.
Thank you very much, Congressman. I'm Roy McCall, an independent analyst. Question, what sort of support and resistance are you finding in Congress for your position, Congressman? And do you sense any change in receptivity based on your more recent trips to mainland China? Thank you.
No, I think it's like the elephant in the room when you go to China. They don't really even want to talk about it because it's kind of right now on ice, the relationship with them, and I just don't even think they want to even acknowledge it or address it. So I don't think that it's necessarily any better. And as far as the Congress is concerned, I think that it's like so many things. It just needs a little push. I think the support is there. And we've reiterated from time to time our commitment to the Taiwan Relations Act as a Congress. I think that the support for Taiwan both among Republicans and Democrats is pretty solid, and the wariness of China is even with a free trader like me, I'm very much a free trader, but I'm still very wary about China's lack of improvement in so many areas that we care about. So I think that all it takes is a catalyst, and I intend to be that catalyst. I think the support's there. Just need a strong voice to start talking about it. And one of the issues just that to me is just a no-brainer and something we're going to probably be taking some movement on is Taiwan's access and entry with Interpol. That's just a no-brainer. And I think if we move with some of the easy ones, the other ones will start falling in line. And I think China's going to have to realize that this obstinance about Taiwan is going to have to see some movement, or it's going to hurt them, and it's going to hurt them economically. And as you said, the first time a major terrorist activity happens, in China, let's say, and they realize because they didn't have an all-hands-on-deck approach, including Taiwan and in some of these international bodies, and being able to receive information from other countries, they're going to regret the fact that they didn't allow all hands on deck. This is not a time to be playing, our parochial games right now. This is a time for all hands on deck. This is a serious global issue, and we need to put our petty self-interests behind us for the interests of once and for all prevailing on this issue.
And the security risks to Taiwan are great, than what they see as the political risks.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. And I think that's one of those things that we just need to muscle through.
Yeah. Okay, next question, John Zhang.
John Zhang with CTI TV of Taiwan. Congressman, you were talking about providing defensive weapons to Taiwan as a major U.S. priority. But there hasn't been any big ticket item for a while. Do you expect, before President Obama leaves office, there will be another a big arms sales announcement? How do you, in Congress, support this push, particularly Taiwan plans to do its own indigenous submarine program? In what way can the United States support? In what way can the U.S. Congress support? Thank you.
Well, one thing that I'm going to answer it in a different way. I don't see the big pivot to Asia that the president said was going to happen. I don't see it having happened. And so I don't know that that kind of support for military sales will come from the administration. I think that it's going to have to be prodded by Congress like we've done before. And I think that that kind of support is pretty strong in Congress on both sides of the aisle, just like it's been for Iron Dome for Israel. I think that kind of support is very, very strong. But I remember the last time I was in China with Congressman Royce, the chairman of the full committee, and we were talking about the nuclear issue in North Korea. And the comment was made, if China doesn't start weighing in more heavily with its tremendous influence over North Korea on this issue, then how can we continue to abate the possibility of a nuclear-armed Taiwan or a nuclear-armed Japan or a nuclear-armed South Korea. And I think that maybe that finally caught their ears. I do think that the support for military sales, a substantial items to Taiwan is there. And I don't think it'll be driven by the administration. I think that's something we're going to have to get the Congress to weigh in a little bit more forcefully on.
Another question? Mr. Slocum? Wait for the microphone, please.
Congressman, thank you for your presentation and your service. I have a question about the politics in Taiwan. What do you think the effect would be if the DPP were to win the next election? Relations between the United States and Taiwan were probably as rocky as they've been for a long, long time during the previous DPP administration.
It's a very interesting question, and I asked that exact same question yesterday to our panel when we had our hearing yesterday, and I didn't really get a satisfactory answer to my question, but you remember when the DPP was in control before, and it was the relationship was on pins and needles every day when Chen Shui-bian was the president of Taiwan. I went over to Taiwan and I made a comment to him, you know, yes, we do have the Taiwan Relations Act, and yes, we are, strong allies of Taiwan and have said that if there's an unprovoked attack, we'll be there to defend Taiwan. But you're acting like the little boy on the playground that goes around taunting the bully because your big brother's standing behind you, and that's not responsible. I'm concerned about that. I really am. If they get back to the DPP controlling the government in Taiwan and get back to inflammatory type comments on a weekly basis, it will strain the relationship and it will put its back in a situation, I think, of great difficulty. And I'm not trying to weigh in to who Taiwan should elect in the next election, but I'm talking as a matter of fact, the last time that the DPP was in control, it did cause some serious conflict in the three-way relationship between the United States, Taiwan, and China. And I think that President Ma, I meant what I said. I think he's to be commended. I know he's taking a lot of political hits and pressure from the constituency there in Taiwan, but he's in a very difficult situation. And I mean what I said. I think he has handled things in a very statesmanlike way. And I hope the people of Taiwan recognize that my feeling about President Ma, and I've spoken with him on the phone, his commitment to Taiwan is very strong. And his commitment to protecting the people of Taiwan is very strong. And he's trying to thread that needle. And I hope the Taiwan people see that as not capitulation or appeasement to China, but coexisting in a very difficult time. And that's my feeling.
Great. Nadia Tsao. Wait for the microphone, please.
Hi, Congressman Nadia Chow, Washington correspondent for Liberty Times. If there's a one single international body that you think Taiwan can join or should, you know, which one that will be, at this moment the Congress will fully support? And from your recent trip to China, a lot of people are talking about Xi Jinping's China dream. What's your assessment about that dream? Some people in this town see that as a dream that will be competitive to U.S. dreams, or even go to different direction. What's your take on that? Thanks.
Could you repeat the last part of the question again?
About Xi Jinping's China dream, during your recent trip.
TPP, China's.
President Xi Jinping's China dream.
Oh.
Yes, so I'm just asking from your
rejuvenation of the Chinese nation.
Yeah. The one China.
Chungguomeng.
Look, I'm going to ask the last question first. My dream is that there is one China one day, and that the government is modeled after Taiwan's government. That it's a democratic process. I know that my hope is that the people of China will ultimately rise up politically and demand the kind of things that come with economic freedom, and that's personal freedoms. the ability to worship according to the dictates of their own conscience, the ability to criticize their government without fear of imprisonment, the ability for the press to be able to report freely what's going on in the country without fear of reprisal. So that's my dream. I think a one China would be great as long as it's a democracy and the people have the ability to select their leaders and not the Communist Party. I think that the dream for one China under the current circumstances with Beijing keeping its thumb on everybody, it, to me, is a pipe dream and not something I support at all. I think that Hong Kong should truly be able to select who their leaders are and not Beijing. And I think that ultimately the Chinese people would love to see, and that includes Taiwan and Hong Kong and China, they'd love to see a peaceful reunification, but not under Beijing's terms. The other question, what body do I think that would be the easiest? I think I mentioned that. I think from a security standpoint, we need to look at those organizations first and foremost that allow Taiwan to do a better job protecting its population. And I think Interpol would be probably my first choice because I think that one's really a no-brainer.
Mm. It's not well known that even though Taiwan lost its seat in the UN in 1971, it was actually part of Interpol until 1984.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
And,
I didn't remember that.
And I learned in doing the research for this report that it had access to the Interpol.
So even in 79, that continued for a few years.
It continued until 1984.
Well, that's just common sense.
Yes.
And to not allow that kind of dissemination of information to all of our law enforcement people is actually just quite ridiculous.
Taiwan has to develop workarounds, and the relationship with the United States, of course, is indispensable in that regard,
right,
as we share information,
right,
because we have, of course, have access to the Interpol database that we then help Taiwan vet the lists of potential suspected persons. So
the problem with that is our agencies don't even communicate adequately among themselves, much less with Taiwan.
Very true, very true. Another question? Mike Fonte.
Mike Fonte, I'm the director of the DPP's office here in Washington. Thanks again, Mr. Salmon, for your presentation. I beat you to Taiwan by 10 years. But I think both of us saw during those days the repression that took place under martial law. And I'm sure you're like me, can't believe the democracy that has developed in Taiwan. I couldn't believe that it happened by 1991. But I think I want to underscore that it is a democracy, that the people of Taiwan have the right to keep all their options open, whatever they may be. And also I would add that Dr. Tsai Ing-wen, who will be the DPP candidate, has said very clearly, I'm not Chen Shui-bian, I'm not Ma Ying-jeou, I'm Tsai Ing-wen. So I think it's important myself that the United States keep itself neutral in this next election round. It didn't do so last time. I wonder what your thoughts are on that.
I agree. I think the United States has to keep neutral. But I think that on principles of cooperation between Taiwan and China, we can't speak about those principles. We should never weigh into an election allow the Taiwan people to select the folks that they believe is most appropriate. And you're right. When I lived in Taiwan, there wasn't a lot of freedom of expression at that point in time. That's a fact. There has been amazing progress in the whole democratic process in Taiwan. At times it's been messy, but that's the way it was in our country too. Very, very difficult. And we had a lot of growing pains dealing with our own democracy. But no, you're completely right, and I hope nobody misconstrues my comments. I wasn't trying to do a campaign commercial. I just think President Ma has had a very difficult row to hoe, so to speak, and I think that he's done a pretty marvelous job accommodating that, but it wasn't meant to be a campaign commercial for him. I like him. I think he's doing a good job, but I'm not going to be putting myself on any bumper stickers for him. I think that you're right. The people of Taiwan need to make that decision. And then in the United States, we will work with whoever they select as their leaders and make the best out of it, absolutely.
Of course, President Ma has already served his two terms, so he won't be running for re-election.
Exactly, and that's my point. So I'm not going to advocate that the Taiwan people select one party or another, but I am going to say that whoever wins needs to be responsible in their rhetoric, because the Taiwan Strait relationship is pretty fragile, and we certainly don't want to provoke a conflict. We don't want to allow despots unfettered, ability to push people around, push Taiwan around. But by the same token, we expect our allies to be responsible in their rhetoric and their actions.
Yes, we do. Very important. Well, I think we've reached the end of our time. It's been a terrific opportunity to have you here, Congressman Salmon, to talk with us about Taiwan. We hope that we will see you again at
CSIS.
Thank
you very much.
And please join me in thanking Congressman Salmon.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're now going to turn to the next part of our program. I'm going to briefly summarize some of what I think are the highlights of our report, and then we will turn to having Ambassador Shen talk with us about his own experiences. So as I said, in 1971, Taiwan lost its seat in the UN, and since then has been excluded from virtually every intergovernmental organization and many non-governmental organizations. And the cost of Taiwan's exclusion is really very significant, but is very rarely discussed. So to highlight the implications of the marginalization of Taiwan from these international cooperation mechanisms, particularly focused on security, my colleague Jacqueline Vitello and I wrote this report to outline the problem and to talk about some of the potential solutions. Security challenges such as proliferation of nuclear weapons and cyber attacks and terrorism are inherently international. They're not confined within a single country's borders. Strengthening security globally requires a seamless network. By not including Taiwan in international regimes and organizations that seek to mitigate these global threats, the world is left with a missing link in an otherwise integrated fight. So the 23 million people on Taiwan are really more vulnerable than citizens elsewhere. And Taiwan is constrained in its ability to contribute its experience and its knowledge to the international community. So some examples from our report. The congressman has just mentioned that Taiwan is excluded from Interpol, which of course is the International Criminal Police Organization. And this includes its system of alerts and its database on criminals. So when there are mega events that are held in Taiwan, and for example, in 2009, Kaohsiung hosted the World Games, there were participants from 103 countries. And the list of athletes and journalists who applied to travel to Taiwan for the games really couldn't be easily and effectively vetted for possible criminals or terrorists through Interpol. And again, as I said, Taiwan had to develop workarounds with its partners, such as the United States. So in doing research for this report, CSIS took a delegation to Taiwan last summer, and former Virginia Governor George Allen and his wife headed our delegation. And we learned that there were several suspicious individuals who eventually were identified, who had applied to participate in the games. They were, of course, barred from entry into Taiwan through a very cumbersome process of investigation. Some of you may know in 2017, Taiwan's going to face a similar challenge. It will be hosting the Summer University Games. This is an international sporting event for university students, and it's second only to the Olympics in terms of number of participants. The expectation is there will be 9,000 athletes from over 170 countries who will attend, and their safety should be a top priority for all of us. Just this week, there was a possible terrorist threat that was posted on Twitter by a user that is believed to be connected to ISIS. And it was apparently a photo of Taipei in ruins and the Taipei 101 tower in flames. So this is a very realistic and urgent issue. Taiwan's security apparatus does heroic work to keep suspicious persons from entering the island. But because they have to rely on bilateral cooperation arrangements with a very small number of countries, obtaining information takes extra time, and the information that is received is not always comprehensive. Taiwan is the world's 10th largest cargo shipper, but it is excluded from the International Maritime Organization, which is a specialized organization of the UN that acts as the global authority for security, safety, and environmental performance in international shipping. So Taiwan is unable to access firsthand the latest regulatory framework and the best practices for the shipping industry. In the realm of nuclear nonproliferation in the international sphere, Taiwan is really essentially a black hole. Its government adheres to the best of its ability to the NPT, the International Treaty on Nonproliferation of Nuclear Weapons, but it faces really dire challenges in these efforts. Lack of coordination between authorities on Taiwan and international bodies have resulted in cases involving Taiwanese companies and Taiwan nationals caught smuggling WMD-sensitive goods to states like Iran and North Korea in the past. Taiwan has significant capabilities and the desire to participate in the Proliferation Security Initiative, which is an informal arrangement among countries that was initiated by the United States, and it seeks to interdict WMD shipments and related goods to terrorists and countries of proliferation concern. There was one very widely publicized incident in 2003. Acting on US intelligence information, Taiwan detained and confiscated 158 barrels of a chemical used to produce rocket fuel. And this was from a North Korean vessel that was docked at a port in Taiwan. Yet Taiwan has been excluded from the nearly 50 interdiction exercises that have been held since PSI's creation. And Beijing is unwilling to endorse the PSI statement of interdiction principles. Let me relate one final example. Taiwan's military has significant capability to contribute to disaster relief, and it has provided assistance to many countries that experience natural disasters, to Indonesia after the tsunami in 2004, to the Philippines after typhoons in 2009 and 2013, to Haiti after the earthquake in 2010. After the Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 went missing, in March of 2014, Malaysian authorities requested that Taiwan join the search effort. Both Taiwan's Navy and Coast Guard dispatched vessels, the Taiwan Air Force sent two C-130 aircraft to search over the South China Sea. However, Taiwan was compelled to withdraw its ships and its aircraft after mainland China objected. And Beijing not only insisted that Malaysia prohibit Taiwan from joining the search effort, it also demanded that Taiwan ships be denied refueling at Malaysia's ports and insisted that the sole citizen from Taiwan on the passenger list be referred to as Chinese. Indeed, the main impediment to Taiwan becoming integrated into international security organizations and activities is mainland China. And Beijing fears that absent an agreement with Taiwan forever enshrining the existence of one China, the island could leverage its presence in international organizations to achieve independence. This fear persists, even though China's ever-growing economic clout really makes it highly unlikely that nations would shift its diplomatic recognition from the PRC to Taiwan. So in our report, we argue that Beijing's obstruction of Taiwan's participation in international organizations is not just harmful to Taiwan and the international community. Ultimately, as Congressman Salmon said, it is also harmful to Chinese interest. China faces growing threats to its own security, such as terrorism, and there's expanded interaction between the two sides of the strait, which of course, while beneficial to cross-strait stability, has created new security risks. There are now 616 flights per week between 10 airports in Taiwan and 54 airports in mainland China. So the potential for criminals or terrorists to transit Taiwan en route to the mainland has grown. By barring Taiwan from becoming a full member of the international community, Beijing, I believe, won't be able to achieve its ultimate goal of winning over the hearts and minds of the people of Taiwan and achieving reunification. The people of Taiwan view participation in IGOs and NGOs as essential to their security, their interests, and their dignity. So our report lays out a series of recommendations of specific actions that should be taken to promote Taiwan's participation in international security efforts and thereby provide greater protection for the citizens of Taiwan and for the rest of the world. There's a long list, so I will just name a few. As we have already highlighted, Taiwan's access to Interpol and particularly to its 24/7 database should be restored. And its National Police Administration should be permitted to observe at annual Interpol General Assembly meetings. Second, Taiwan should be permitted to contribute to global counterterrorism efforts by joining the Financial Action Task Force. And that's the primary body that sets the standards, promotes effective implementation of measures for combating money laundering, terrorist financing, and other threats to the integrity of the international financial system. Taiwan should be granted observership in the International Civil Aviation Organization Council. Taiwan participated in the assembly meeting in 2013 as a guest of the president of ICAO, but it should be permitted observership in the council and allowed to participate in council meetings as well as gain access to ICAO's secure database. And Taiwan should be permitted to participate in international and regional organizations involved in humanitarian assistance and disaster relief through the UN as well as through APEC. So finally, Taiwan, of course, must make its own full faith efforts to demonstrate that it is qualified for and deserves expanded participation in international organizations. So Taiwan, of course, should actively publicize its advanced expertise and its willingness and desire to contribute to global security endeavors, to intensify its diplomatic efforts, to obtain support from other countries for an increased role in international security cooperation. And finally, Taiwan should work to convince the mainland that obstructing Taiwan's international role, is contrary to Chinese interests as well. And we all need to help in that regard. So I encourage you all to read the report and to think seriously about how we can promote Taiwan's participation in the international community focused on security institutions going forward. So with that, we are now going to turn to the final portion of our program today. And it's a privilege to have with us Ambassador Shen Lushun, whom, as all of you know, is a representative of the Taipei Economic and Cultural Representative Office in the United States. Ambassador Shen is both a distinguished diplomat and an accomplished historian. And while Congressman Salmon was doing his mission in Taiwan from 1977 to 1979, Shen Lushun was studying at the University of Pennsylvania, first obtaining his master's degree and then his PhD. He was subsequently posted to the United States six times during his career and took up his current post in April of last year. Prior to that, Ambassador Shen served as Taiwan's representative in the UK, and before that, as representative to the European Union and Belgium. Ambassador Shen is presiding over, as well as contributing to, a golden period in U.S.-Taiwan relations. And he has earned deep respect and gratitude for his untiring service to Taiwan and to the U.S.-Taiwan bilateral relationship. Over the years that we have known each other, and I won't say how many, in the many conversations that I have had with Ambassador Shen, I have always learned a great deal. And so I very much look forward to his remarks today. So please join me in welcoming Shen Lushun. My turn, please. Your turn.
Thank you, Bonnie. I have known Bonnie ever since she was a little girl. Good morning and Happy New Year. Today is still the seventh day of the year of the ship, right? And keep in mind, this is not the year 2015. According to the Chinese calendar, this year is the year 4,713, all right? But I really don't know whether the Chinese history is that long. This is according to Google, of course. This morning, I first want to thank you, Bonnie and Jacqueline, for a very thorough professional report. Well done. Excuse me. And my job this morning is to endorse, to echo, or to supplement your arguments with my own experience as a Taiwan diplomat for 33 years. I think I can find a lot of interesting cases to support your arguments. And let's start from, you know, this year we worry about Ebola. But remember 12 years ago, also the year of the ship, 2003, remember there was a outbreak of a very weird epidemic disease in East Asia, originated from China, and Taiwan became maybe the second largest victim. Disease called SARS, excuse me. And then I remember Taiwan reported our first SARS case to WHO on March the 14th. WHO did not respond until May the 5th. For 6 weeks, we stood alone without any external help. We didn't know what happened, we didn't know what to do. Now, instead, who came to us within that 6 weeks? That was American CDC experts. So, we're very grateful to the Americans. And right at this time, I got an emergency transfer order to transfer me from here. I was a deputy representative at that time, to transfer me here to Geneva as a chief of mission. Now, in Geneva, of course, we tried to do something. Again, we thank Americans. We thank our diplomatic allies. We tried to get some access to WHO about, you know, how to deal with SARS. WHO also, in a way, I think a lot of people there are very kind. Because of Taiwan, they arranged, because we are not a member nor observer, and also the objection from Beijing. So they arranged, not in the formal agenda, they arranged for a lunch briefing so that our health minister could speak to present Taiwan's case. Every victim, victim country could present its case. But only about half an hour before the event started, I got a phone call from some high-level people of WHO saying that because of the objection from Chinese ambassador, the PRC ambassador, our health minister could not speak. And then they even told me that Dr. Brundtland, the DG, Director General of the WHO, even, even had an argument with the PRC ambassador saying that you don't need to take Taiwanese minister as a minister, you just take him as an expert. But Chinese ambassador still saying no. And then Dr. Brundtland said, you just take him as a person without affiliation. But the answer is still no. So we couldn't speak for ourselves. And then who spoke for us? Again, we think of the Americans. There was an assistant DG, assistant director general, was American, Dr. David Heyman, presented the case for Taiwan. And the, but of course we, my health minister and I, we could sit in the audience to listen. And this is very funny. You know, when the Chinese health, I think it's deputy minister of health, spoke for their case, and the PowerPoint statistics, everything, didn't refer themselves as China or PRC. They only refer themselves as mainland China. Why? Because they don't have Taiwan figures. They don't have Hong Kong figures. If they say this is Chinese figures, if they say this is Chinese total, or the PRC total cases, it would not include Taiwan. It didn't include Hong Kong. So they could not speak for Taiwan, even though They bar us from speaking, but still they couldn't speak for us. And this is in my 33 years of diplomatic career, this is probably one of the very, very rare occasions that they call themselves only mainland China, as we call them, rather than China or the People's Republic of China. Now, again, through American help, we managed to pass a resolution to help not just Taiwan, but everyone who needs help. It's called SARS resolution. But again, the People's Republic tried to stop that because the original language says that the DG, the Director General of WHO, has to respond to the request from all countries, including non-member states. Of course, you know who is against that. So later, it takes very skillful diplomats to do that. Later, we sent American help, we changed the words into DEG has to respond to all requests, meaning the requests from non-member states, such as Taiwan. Okay, because of that, Taiwan will be entitled to send our experts to a global SARS conference held in June 2003, if you remember. And Taiwan, as the second largest victim country, we are very experienced. We need to send our experts. And yes, we can get invitations. Now, guess what happened? So, Bonnie, I would supplement you with footnotes, a lot of footnotes. Guess what happened? Invitation letters. The People's Republic of China mission in Geneva demanded that invitation letters be for the Taiwan experts be sent to them, and then they would forward to Beijing. And then in Beijing, there's an NGO called Chinese Medical Association, Zhonghua Yiyaohui. They put a covering letter on top of this WHO invitation saying that we are concerned about the health of our Taiwan compatriots, so we secure this invitation for you. My dear friends, by the time we got the invitation letter, it's already too late for us to go. Now, so what we did, the Taiwan diplomat didn't just sit there idly and wait. I went directly to WHO people. I got electronic invitation for our experts. So I was like, with the email invitation, we could go to Malaysia Global SARS Conference. So it really takes a lot of efforts. Now, after this SARS, let me tell you another interesting thing. You know, in WHO, they have the website to show the world map of the communicable or epidemic diseases. So usually, it's a country having still have the disease, the country would be painted red. And this also caused a problem because of one China policy. You know, for example, malaria, Taiwan already got rid of that as long as early 1960s. We had a certificate, the WHO certificate. But mainland China still had that. So because mainland China, sometimes we've all been painted red. So I went to complain. I was saying this would be detrimental to our image, or probably would hurt our tourism. But the other side insisted. So at one time I asked WHO people, I said, can you ask the other side if there's a disease, only Taiwan has it, and mainland China didn't have it, are they willing to be painted all red because of Taiwan? The answer came back saying that, yes, we still be willing to be painted all red because of one China policy and because of our love for our Taiwan compatriots. But later, WHO made some adjustments because this is absurd. And they also themselves said this is a little too scary if you paint it all red. So the map became areas map, not go by countries, go by areas. Certain areas to have, you know, in a big country, maybe a few provinces having that. But there's one map. It has to go by the countries, which is, if you remember in 2005, the WHA passed a, what they call IHR, International Health Regulations, which is something which combined altogether 11 old international health conventions into a new one. So every country has to abide by that, every country has to implement that. And then, thanks to American help, there was a clause about universality, which means even non-member states, such as Taiwan, such a holy see, would have to abide by that because, you know, disease knows no political boundaries. So, and then there will be a very big electronic map in the lobby of WHO building showing, because they have 1 year to let you prepare yourselves. If you're ready, the country would be painted green. If you're half ready, it will be yellow. If you're still not ready at all, it will be red. But Taiwan's have been ready very early stage, so we became green color. Mainland China is still not ready, so they are red. Now this caused a problem. And but later, WHO didn't know what to do. Let me tell you what happened later. Later, WHO shut down the whole map altogether. So this shows to you, you bar Taiwan from participation in international organization. You hurt not only yourself, you hurt all the countries in the world. This really doesn't make sense. This is a true, again, a true story. Now, having said that, let me also give you a few more observations. Bonnie, I think the word Taiwan being marginalized, in a way, is probably an understatement because a lot of occasions, especially UN specialized agencies, Taiwan's been totally excluded. You know, sometimes I usually say, when I was in Geneva, because in Geneva every year, there are more than 7,000 international organization meetings, seminars, assemblies. Sometimes I'm saying to my friends, we don't even know what we have missed because we don't know the total picture. And this is in a way dangerous, even though we try very hard to get the papers, to the documents, to get the UN standards, the UN new standards, regulations, and we can report back to make Taiwan up to international standard, to make Taiwan's domestic laws, regulations synchronized with UN standards. But sometimes we don't even know what we have missed. So I will say marginal, to be marginalized, is probably even an understatement. In a way, we've been totally excluded. But we thanks two factors which make the situation better. One is the American help. I would say sometimes when international organizations shut their doors to Taiwan, but Americans try to open window for us. This is why we're very grateful. You know, a lot of occasions, American health attaché in Geneva is probably my best friend at that time. And this is why today, when we are able and willing to reciprocate, we also go through American channels. Now we worry about Ebola. Our channel to WHO is still not so good. So instead of going to WHO, we rather donate our money. Last 2 months ago, we donated $1 million to the CDC Foundation for Ebola control. We donate because we know SARS, we suffer from SARS a lot, so we're probably more experienced. We donated 100,000 sets of what they call PPE, personal protective equipment. We are in the process, in cooperation with the United States, in setting up a regional training center for Ebola control and prevention in Taiwan. So we still have a very close cooperation with the United States in trying to get Taiwan. We're not just standing here to receive the help from others from the outside world, we try to reciprocate, we try to donate, we try to pay back as well, but it was through the American. This is why I'm saying we're very grateful when the international organizations close doors, Americans try to open the window for us. Also, we have to thank, I want to echo Congressman Salmon, we have to thank President Ma's policy, because under his policy, the cross-strait relationship being improved to a certain extent that allows Taiwan to have more international space. So finally, we don't have to have a big fight in WHA. Now we become a observer of WHA and also a guest of ICAO. Let me tell you, in the old days, we really waste everybody's time in WHA because, you know, every year, WHA only lasts for 8 days or 10 days. The first day is probably the most important. The first day is probably someone like me together with our diplomatic allies. We can stage a filibuster. And one time I apologized to Health Minister of the Kingdom of Tonga because he said he had to fly for 25 hours to come to Geneva. And Geneva's hotel is very expensive. He could only stay for 2 days. But his very first day with WHA, the thing he heard is nothing but Taiwan, Taiwan, Taiwan. So later we tried to reach a compromise. We tried to save everybody's time. You know, when we had a debate, we can maybe have a 2x2 or 3x3 to save time. But another thing we could do is that we can call for a vote. We know, I learned from US Congress, you know, how you try to call, not just a vote, not just a voice vote, we call a roll call vote. Now, you try to imagine out of 193 member states, a roll call, you have to call twice. How much time it would cost? And then after the vote, according to, I think, Article 77 of the regulations, every member is entitled to make a speech to explain his vote. And then we have, even though we only have some 25 diplomatic allies, but you can imagine each and everyone making a long speech. So it's very time consuming. So we're very grateful to President Ma's policy. And then today we don't have to do that. We already become a WHA observer. And then the next point, I have to say, Taiwan's too big to ignore. You mentioned maritime. I can tell you another organization called ILO, International Labor Organization. You know, originally when I tried to approach them, they were not interested in me at all. They even told me that when they tried to, if they came to lunch with me, they need first get a green light from other side's mission. But later they came to me, why? Because they said they sent a delegation to Southern Africa, went to the kingdoms of Lesotho and Swaziland, and found that the textile industry there almost dominated by Taiwan investors. So they saying, they gave me the papers, they saying, we have a new labor standards, please apply them, not just in Taiwan, but also in your overseas investment countries. I told them, Taiwan is the seventh largest outbound investing country in the world. You need to let us know about the new international labor standards so we can apply them, not just in Taiwan, but in our overseas investment countries. This is in the interest of everyone. All right? Okay, we talk about maritime. As you said, Taiwan is probably the sixth largest maritime country in the world. Evergreen is one of the largest shipping lines in the world. So when the WHO, the ILO, I'm sorry, adopted Seafarers Labor Standard Convention, they gave, even though we couldn't be a signatory, they gave me a copy and wanted us to apply them on our ships, on our fishing boats. And then last but not least, let me just tell you, again, as I said, Taiwan is too big to ignore. Well, you mentioned ICAO. Let me tell you how big Taiwan is when it comes to ICAO matters. The Taipei FIR, Flight Information Region, FIR, which is under our exclusive air traffic control, it's not just as big as the size of island Taiwan, you know, the airspace of Taiwan, no. Altogether, as in the old days, because a lot of the space over the public sea was assigned to us, altogether it's about 195,000 square kilometers, including a very big piece of airspace in the East China Sea. So it's about 6 times the size of the island of Taiwan. How many international flights, how many flights using Taipei FIR? According to our figures, every year about 1.4 million to 1.8 million control flights using Taipei FIR, meaning they need our service, they need our guidance. Among them, there are 69 commercial airliners from 30 countries, including United, including British Airways. Some of them probably didn't land in Taiwan, they fly over Taiwan. So we hold It's such a big piece of international airspace, and that's our responsibility. And then you mentioned now we have so many flights with mainland China. Every week we have 1,656 direct flights with mainland China. We have about 400 direct flights with the United States. Among them, 280 are passenger flights, 120 are cargo flights. So this is an international concern. And this also involves PRC's own national interests. So we all have to take a serious look at the problem. If you cut Taiwan out of the system, not only you create a problem for Taiwan, you create a problem for yourself, because there will be a big gap there. And I dare say, as a conclusion, that the UN specialized agencies need Taiwan as much as we need them. And only Taiwan can speak for itself on international occasions, not the others. But this morning, I would love to have you two ladies speak for Taiwan. We thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Over here, Ambassador. Please sit down so that you can take a few questions.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your remarks. It's just fascinating listening to your personal experiences in your career, and I'm sure that virtually every diplomat from Taiwan, regardless of where they serve, would have such stories to tell, because there are so many instances in which diplomats have had to work so hard in order to ensure that Taiwan's citizens and security is protected, and to try and make opportunities for Taiwan's enhanced participation in the international community. So I would just like to ask one question before we open the floor, give you an opportunity maybe to tell us what else you would like to see the United States do, whether it be the executive branch or the Congress, in order to promote this agenda. And I believe the U.S. is doing a great deal, and I'm sure you would agree. But because of the really slow, even glacial progress in expanding Taiwan's international space, so the question is, you know, really, what more can be done?
I think the United States really has been doing a lot. But the problems remain. This United States is only one member
right.
of so many international organizations. So I think we need to line up. If the United States could be of any further help, we hope United States can even help to line up what we call like-minded countries. This is, of course, is still very difficult. But I think it's our responsibility, because basically this is our problem. We should go out even more proactively to line up like-minded countries. So gradually when I was in UK, you know, for example, the British also very supportive of our ICAO. Participation. And then the number one problem, of course, coming from Beijing. So I think at this stage, we hope we can, at least we let everybody know about the, we can set aside the political or diplomatic disputes or whatever. We concentrate on technical issues. You know, for example, when ICAO had an international meeting of 188 of the member states right after 9/11, Taiwan could not go there. We do not even know how thick the cockpit doors should be, whether the pilots should be allowed to carry firearms, things like that. These are very technical things. And then people saying that, oh, we will tell Beijing, Beijing will tell you. It's too late. I can tell you in many cases. When I was in Geneva, there was a case about the poisoned baby corn from Thailand. So WHO informed Beijing, asked Beijing to forward to us. And it happened that Beijing that time enjoying their golden week, Huang Jingzhou, you know, October the 1st. So they delayed it for 9 days. So when we received the notification, it already been a little bit too late. But this is why we appreciate American help. So finally, also because of the improvement of cross-strait relationship, now we can be a WHA observer. Also, we now can have a direct access, communication, exchange with the WHO, what they call contact point right. in Geneva. So we hope in every international organizations of this sort, we could have this. This is what we call, to use a general term, we call meaningful participation. Mm. Not just go there once a year, sitting there, listening to others, but we can have day to day, because it's very much needed.
Yes.
You know, as we always say, disease knows no political boundaries. Terrorists, as you said, they probably don't care. Just because you are not a UN member, you're probably even more vulnerable.
More vulnerable.
You
yes.
probably make yourself even, you know, yes. easier target. So we have to keep all these things in. Mm-hmm. And then given the close relationship, you know, people to people change between two sides, Taiwan Strait, the PRC interests also at stake. Mm-hmm. They probably would be number one country or place which would be affected if something happens to Taiwan, God forbid.
Mm-hmm. Yes, as Congressman Salmon said, common sense.
Common sense.
Let's open the floor to questions. Again, please identify yourself and please make sure you're asking a question. Yes, over here.
Thank you, Ambassador Shen. I'm Roy McCall, independent analyst. I'm just curious, despite the PRC freeze on formal relations, on a personal level, do they ever come up to you and say, you know, I know I have to represent this position, but on a personal level, let's be friends or let's talk, anything like that going on in Geneva or
You know,
here?
I, myself, with them?
Yes.
With the PRC diplomats? No, never. No personal relationship at all. They, at one time, I can tell you, as I told you, Barney, my great-great-grandfather, Viceroy Shen Baozhen, was the top leader in Taiwan in 1874-1875. So in mainland China, they published a pictorial about my great-great-grandfather. At one time, I think the PRC diplomats, through a reporter, you know, and one sent me the copy. So I thank them. First, they're very polite. You know, they said whether I could have received. Mm-hmm. I said, of course, I'd be interested. Mm-hmm. But they sent it to me on our National Day. So I sent a message back. I said, thank you for the National Day gift. So that's.
Oh, that's
but
a great
I also thank for their kindness. But no personal contact. You know, we probably sometimes cross over. We know each other. Know of each other, but I never said hello, we never had any personal relationship, okay?
Hopefully that will change in the future. Other questions? Okay, Mr. Slocum.
This may be an awkward, first of all, thank you, Ambassador. This may be an awkward question, but there is another entity whose access to international organizations is often a matter of controversy, and that's the PLO.
Uh-huh.
Is there any, I mean, in some sense, Taiwan's case is we should be able to participate as an observer. Sometimes the PLO makes the same argument. Are there other cases of entities that have de facto control? I mean, Taiwan has much more control than the PLO does, that seek international access to these international organizations, and do you in any way communicate with them about trying to get a common position of access to these organizations?
I think if we compare our case to PLO, it would only complicate the question to a very, very large extent. It probably does not serve anybody's interests. And the yes, we sometimes look at what the PLO been doing. Actually, in WHA, every year there are only two very political resolutions or issues. One is Taiwan. Another is what they call the health rights of Palestinian people. But those two cases are very different. So we probably could not compare. In a way, they have they probably have a better position than Taiwan. But we probably, for us, for our immediate interest, I think our access to specialized agencies probably more important. So I don't think these two cases are comparable. Okay, thank you.
Another question? Yes, in the front here.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ambassador. A quick question for you. ASEAN integration.
Could you please identify yourself?
Oh, Shant Kirkorian.
Did you say three questions?
Quick question for you. I can ask three if you'd like.
Thank you.
ASEAN integration is increasing this year. Mm-hmm. A lot of people have noted that ASEAN may be a quasi-EU in Asia. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if the EU itself has access to a lot of these specialized organizations. If Taiwan joins ASEAN, wouldn't this be a middle ground for Taiwan to get access to these organizations? If Taiwan was an ASEAN member and ASEAN is represented, if integration continues as well? I know there's a lot of ifs in this question, but wouldn't this be a middle ground for Taiwan so its interests are also represented in Geneva, in The Hague, in Vienna, et cetera? Thank you.
Thank you. I would say, again, that would only complicate the problems. We would rather, just because, you know, knocking at the UN's door is very difficult, but I think we already managed to open some, if not the doors, but the windows. But if you go through another one, that probably even complicate the situation. I would rather just go directly to UN and UN specialized agencies. After all, as I said, some organizations, they couldn't ignore us. IAEA, for example, they have to, because they also come to Taiwan for the nuclear, you know, the inspection of our nuclear power plants, things like that. We already have had certain kind of a de facto relationship, and so I don't think the go through another international organization or would be a good idea.
Other questions? Yes, over here.
Hi, my name is Alex Wang, Wang Yuanrui. I'm a Taiwanese junior studying international relations at GW here in Washington. And I really love my country, Taiwan. And I actually just took a year off and I finished my military service in Taiwan. And I have a question for you, Shen Dasi. What would you urge us Taiwanese young new generation to do to help preserve the Taiwanese identity, this rich culture and traditional Chinese society? What would you urge me to do in the future?
What a great question.
I think you should ask yourself. You know, we...
The older generation
are our mentors. Please be seated.
Okay.
And maybe the most practical thing you can do is that after you got your degree, go back to Taiwan, join Taiwan's Foreign Service. Okay? And then I would say, I do believe that we have to continue this present mass policy. Even though I know, you know, he suffered from a lot of domestic criticism. But no matter what happens, no matter who wins the next election, I think President Ma is very right in saying that mainland China is still our largest source of potential threat. But on the other hand, it's also our biggest land of opportunities. So what we're doing now is we have to be very skillful, try to manage this relationship, try to minimize the threat, but maximize the opportunities. Not just shut us out from saying that you are hostile, you are not friendly, we don't want to deal with you. No. So we have to try to minimize the threat and maximize the opportunities. And that takes a lot of it. It takes courage. It takes very skillful management. So I would say, as a Taiwanese young man, you know, my father's generation, they fought the civil war between Mao Zedong and Chiang Kai-shek for almost 60 years. My generation, we thank President Ma and, you know, our other leaders, that we managed to turn things around. Now I have at least a peaceful framework or prospect. We turned the civil war into today's situation, but still there are thousands, there are so many problems. But at least we hope we can pave a peaceful way for your generation to really settle the problems. So it's really up to you. What we can do is probably make sure for any resolution is a peaceful resolution. But it's up to you to manage this relationship. It's not easy. But I think this is a question you have to ask yourself. But you ask me, probably the most practical thing for you to do is after you get your degree, go back to Taiwan, join Foreign Service, and to experience those problems yourself.
You are about the same age as my son, and my advice to you would be the same as it is to him, to find something you are passionate about. There are thousands of ways to make a contribution, to really make a difference. And so you find something you're passionate about and work hard for your nation and for the rest of the world. So I think we'll take one last question, okay, over here in front.
My name is Annie Chen. I'm a senior at Georgetown University. My question for Ambassador Shen is, in order for the U.S. to facilitate Taiwan's participation in IGOs and NGOs, and in order for the PRC to agree and even participate in this facilitation process, what are the areas in terms of sovereignty claims, ideology, values, et cetera, that the US, PRC, and Taiwan, what are the areas that these three parts can come to agreements on, and what are the differences that you think are for sure to remain, and what are the differences that cannot be compromised and reconciled? Thank you.
Wow.
That's a difficult question.
That's a very, very difficult question.
It is.
I would have to say maybe we better start from functional areas, which is probably easier than political questions. This is why when we, you know, about 15, 20 years ago, when we tried to knock at the doors of the UN, we started with, you know, organizations such as WHO, ICAO, UNFCCC, rather than going directly to UNGA, General Assembly. So. But it really takes a lot of effort, as we have discussed. But hopefully someday, maybe your generation, someday you would have once for all a across-the-board solution. But I don't see that as possible at this moment. So what we can say, this is why we use this word called meaningful participation, just because we know for Taiwan to become a member or observer of UN is very difficult. But first, we need to have de facto participation, de facto access, so that at least to make this world, to make the UN system, the UN regulations, UN resolutions global, without, as Barney said, a missing link, without gaps, because Taiwan is too big to ignore. As I told you, how big is our airspace? Our FIR, I can give you a long list of how big we are. And this is something that in the interest of not just Taiwan, but the rest of the world, also in the interest of PRC. You cut Taiwan out, it will be a lose-lose-lose situation. But if you include Taiwan and set aside the political problem for the time being, hopefully it will be a win-win-win situation. That's what we are working for.
Well, that's a terrific note to end on, and I'm very optimistic. We will keep working together and with the rest of the international community. Please thank you all for coming, and please join me in thanking Ambassador Shen.